الحمد لله رب العالمين، والصلاة والسلام على خير خلق الله نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين ومن تبعهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. هذا هو الشيخ مقبل الحربي. He's one of the teachers in the Islamic University of Medina, specifically the best faculty, the faculty of Hadith. And his lecture will be pertaining to the conditions for your actions to be accepted by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. فليتفضل مشكورا
شيخ. تكون جملة جملة؟
نعم
تكون جملة جملة؟
جيد
جبرت على
طيب
الله يكرمك.
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين، وصلى الله وسلم وبارك على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين، ومن اهتدى بهديه واستنى بسنته إلى يوم الدين. والله أسأل أن يجعل هذا اللقاء لقاء مباركا، وأن ينفعنا جميعا بما نقول ونسمع، وأن يهدينا صراطه المستقيم. وأول ما أبدأ به الترحيب بكم قائلا السلام عليكم ورحمة الله تعالى وبركاته، وأهلا وسهلا بكم، وجزاكم الله خيرا على هذه الفرصة وعلى هذا اللقاء، والله أسأل التوفيق والسداد للجميع.
The Sheikh, may Allah preserve him, starts off by praising Allah, the Mighty and Majestic, and making dua for Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Then he asks Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make this gathering a gathering which is blessed, a gathering which is beneficial from that which we, and allows us to benefit from that which we say and that which we hear. And the Shaykh, he says, يرحب بكم, he welcomes all of you and thanks all of you for attending today. And he asks Allah to grant all of us success.
تعلمون جميعا أن الله تبارك وتعالى ما خلق الخلق إلا لعبادته وحده لا شريك له، وما أنزل الكتب وأرسل الرسل إلا لهذه الغاية العظيمة.
The Sheikh starts off by saying that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created us for a lofty purpose and reason, that is his worship. And he did not send the prophets and reveal the books except for this lofty reason.
وأرسل الرسل لبيان كيفية هذه العبادة وكيف يعبد الله الناس الله تبارك وتعالى ويأخذ بهذا الهدي وهذا الشرع ولا يخرج عنه قيد أنملة.
And repeating what the Sheikh mentioned, he said that Allah sent the prophets to clarify and show and give detail of how to worship, how this worship is, and set the boundaries for this worship, that so that the people do not go outside the boundaries set of this worship by the prophets and messengers.
وَتَعْلَمُونَ أَنَّ هَذِهِ الدُّنْيَا مَزْرَعَةُ الْآخِرَةِ فهذه الدنيا دار عمل والآخرة دار جزاء ولا عمل.
And the Sheikh said, all of you know that this worldly life is considered a farm for the hereafter, i.e. a place to seed for the hereafter. Now this dunya is the realm of action, and the hereafter is the realm of recompense, of seed, of harvest, of sowing and harvesting that which you've already seeded.
وقد ورد في كتاب الله تبارك وتعالى شروط قبول هذا العمل الذي يتعبد به المرء ربه سبحانه وتعالى.
And in the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, it's mentioned the conditions for your worship, for your actions to be accepted.
وكذلك ورد في سنة النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم ما يدل على ذلك.
And likewise in the prophetic sunnah of our Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, what shows and emphasizes what is required for your actions to be accepted by Allah.
قال الله تعالى فمن كان يرجو لقاء ربه فليعمل عملا صالحا ولا يشرك بعبادة ربه أحدا. فهذه الآية تدل على شرطين عظيمين لقبول العمل عند الله تبارك وتعالى، وهما: أولا عمل باطن وهو الإخلاص لله تبارك وتعالى في هذا العمل، الثاني هو أن يكون صالحا وصلاحه أن يكون موافقا لهدي النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم وسنته.
From the verses which show the conditions for your actions to be accepted is the statement of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, فَمَنْ كَانَ يَرْجُوا لِقَاءَ رَبِّهِ فَلْيَعْمَلْ عَمَلًا صَالِحًا وَلَا يُشْرِكْ بِعِبَادَةِ رَبِّهِ أَحَدًا. Meaning, whomsoever hopes in the meeting of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then let him perform righteous actions, number one, وَلَا يُشْرِكْ بِعِبَادَةِ رَبِّهِ أَحَدًا, and let him not associate any partners with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So this ayah, this noble verse, clarifies two conditions, the two major conditions for your actions to be accepted. The first of them is a hidden apparent affair, i.e. the sincerity for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, number one. And number two, that it's a righteous action. That this action of yours is action which is good and righteous, meaning in accordance to the sunnah of our Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam.
فَهَذَا الْمِيزَانِ الَّذِي تعرض عليه الأعمال ميزان الإخلاص وهو الباطن الذي لا يعلمه إلا الله عز وجل، والله تعالى لا ينظر إلى صورنا ولكن ينظر إلى قلوبنا.
And this is the scale which all of your actions are to be weighed upon, these two conditions. The first condition of sincerity, and this condition is a condition which nobody knows except Allah, as it's a hidden affair. Nobody knows what's in your heart except Allah. The Shaykh mentioned the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, "Inna Allah la yanzuru ila suwarikum wa ajsadikum," that indeed Allah does not look at your bodies and your shapes, rather He looks at what's in your hearts.
فالقلب هو مستودع الإيمان واليقين. فإذا وقر الإيمان في قلب العبد وآمن بربه فإن القلب ملك للأعضاء الأخرى في بدن الإنسان هو يأمرها، فإذا صلح القلب صلحت الأعضاء الأخرى بصلاحه. يقول عليه الصلاة والسلام: ألا إن في الجسد مضغة إذا صلحت صلح الجسد كله وإذا فسدت فسد الجسد كله ألا وهي القلب.
The Shaykh mentions that this heart of ours is مستودع الإيمان واليقين, that it's the container for إيمان, faith, and يقين, certainty. And this heart, if it's upright and correct and righteous, everything else will follow in suit. The Shaykh mentions that the heart is ملك الأعضاء, is the king of all of the limbs and the king of the rest of the body. What's the proof for this? It's the same of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Indeed, in the body is a muscle of flesh. If it's upright, if it's correct, if it's sound, the rest of the body will be upright, correct and sound. And if it's incorrect and corrupt, the rest of the body will likewise be corrupt. أَلَا وَهِي الْقَلْبِ, indeed it is the heart, this muscle of flesh.
فَإِذَا أَخْلَصَ الْعَبْدُ عمله لله تبارك وتعالى ولم يشرك به شيئا فإن هذا العمل الأول وهذا الميزان الأول الذي يعرض عليه العمل. فإذا كان العمل خالصا لوجه الله تبارك وتعالى بعيدا عن الشرك والرياء وغير ذلك من حظوظ الدنيا فإنه عندئذ يعني يكون هذا العمل خالصا لله تبارك وتعالى، يقصد به العبد ربه عز وجل، يخلص له في عبادته ويتقرب إلى ربه بهذا العمل. نعم.
And if the servant makes his actions sincere for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and solely for his purpose, then this is the first condition of the scales that your actions are going to be weighed upon. And Shaykh means sincerity, i.e. far away from shirk, far away from associating partners with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, far away from riya, showing off and wanting to be acknowledged by others, far away from any worldly purpose, from the purposes of the dunya. And your actions, you're seeking the face of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you're seeking the reward of Allah and only Allah's pleasure alone.
ولهذا يقول النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم إنما الأعمال بالنيات، فإذا كانت النية خالصة لله تبارك وتعالى في ذلك العمل فاعلم أن هذا العمل بإذن الله مقبولا عند الله، لأن النية خالصة فيه لله تبارك وتعالى.
And for this very reason, the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم said إنما الأعمال بالنيات. The actions are according to the intentions. So if your action is sincere for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, one that is only for his sake, inshallah ta'ala, this will be a means for your actions to be accepted.
ولذا هاجر مع النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم وأبي بكر رجل، لكنه لم يرد بذلك الهجرة، وإنما أراد امرأة يتزوجها بالمدينة، فقال النبي عليه الصلاة والسلام فمن كانت هجرته إلى الله ورسوله فهجرته إلى الله ورسوله، ومن كانت هجرته إلى امرأة ينكحها فهجرته إلى ما هاجر إليه.
When the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam migrated and did hijrah from Mecca to Medina with his companions, amongst them was a person who migrated not for the sake of Allah and the sake of his messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam, but rather for a particular woman who was in Al-Medina at the time. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, so whomsoever's hijrah is for Allah and his messenger, then his hijrah is for Allah and his messenger, and whomsoever's hijrah is for a woman to marry our worldly purpose, hijratuhu ila ma hajara ilayhi, then his hijrah, his migration is for whatever he migrated for.
هذا الميزان الأول وهو ميزان باطل، باطن لا يعلمه إلا الله، ميزان القلب، والإخلاص في العمل لله تبارك وتعالى. والميزان الثاني ميزان ظاهر، وهو متابعة النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم في أعماله وفي أوامره وفي نواهيه، وأن لا يعبد الله تبارك وتعالى إلا بما شرع النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم، فهو المبلغ عن الله، وهو الذي لا ينطق إلا بوحي من الله تبارك وتعالى.
And this is the first scale or the first yardstick when it comes to your actions, and that is something, an affair which is hidden. That is the sincerity for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. As for the second condition and the second thing which your actions are going to be weighed upon is something which is apparent, something which is not hidden, and that is following the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Following him in his actions, following him in his commandments, following him in his prohibitions. For indeed the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is al-muballighu anillah, the one who is reporting back from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, reporting on behalf of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. For indeed he does not speak from his own desires, it's only revelation being revealed to him sallallahu alayhi wa sallam.
ولذا جميع عباداتنا إن لم تكن موافقة لهدي النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم فإنه لا فائدة منها ولا تقبل. ولهذا يقول صلى الله عليه وسلم صلوا كما رأيتموني أصلي، وقال في الحج خذوا عني مناسككم، وكذلك حذر من المخالفة في ذلك، وقال من عمل عملا ليس عليه أمرنا فهو رد، أي مردود على صاحبه وغير مقبول عند الله تبارك وتعالى.
So all of our actions, actions of worship, if it's not number one sincerely for Allah's sake, number two in line in accordance to the sunnah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, then there is no benefit in it. لا فائدة. There's no benefit in it. And more importantly, won't be accepted. That's why the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, صَلُّوا كَمَا رَأَيْتُمُونِي أُصَلِّي. Pray as you have seen me pray. That's why he said also, خُذُوا عَنِّي مَنَاسِكَكُمْ. Take from me your rituals, i.e. the rituals and the actions of Hajj. That's why the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, whoever does action which is not upon our way, i.e. Islam, فَهُوَ رَدًّا. It will be rejected and thrown back to him.
ولهذا ينقسم الناس بين هذين الأصلين وهو الإخلاص ومتابعة النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم في العمل إلى أربعة أقسام. قسم منهم لا إخلاص عنده ولا متابعة، ولكنه يتمسح بزي المسلمين ويبتدع في دين الله ما لم يأذن به الله تبارك وتعالى، فهذا بعيد عن الإخلاص وبعيد عن منهج النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم، فأنى يقبل عمله، نسأل الله السلامة. ليس إخلاص عنده ولا متابعة لهدي النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم، ولكنه يرائي الناس بهيئته وببدعته ويتمسح بتلك الصور وبتلك الأشكال، لكنه بعيد كل البعد عن هدي النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم، مثل ما يصنع كثير من المبتدعة. أين الإخلاص في عملهم وأين المتابعة في سلوكهم لطريق النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم؟ بل هم مخالفون له كما ترون. نعم.
As for it pertains to these two conditions, the conditions of actions being accepted, the first being sincerity and the second being following the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, then the people split into four different categories. As for the first of them, is the people who have no sincerity and at the same time they don't follow the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. In other words, they have not come with any of two conditions: no sincerity and no following of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. But these people, they are people, they have their form of Islam. They take shape as a Muslim. They may dress like us, they may talk like us. So now has, and this is the like of the people of innovation. They have no sincerity in their actions when they do it for other than the sake of Allah, nor have they followed the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam in the acts of worship. فَأَنَّا يُقْبَلْ عِبَادَتَهُمْ. Then how will their actions ever be accepted? No sincerity, and nor is it in line with the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam sunnah.
القسم الثاني من الناس عنده إخلاص لله تبارك وتعالى في العمل، لكن ليست عنده متابعة للنبي صلى الله عليه وسلم، وهذا أيضا إن خرم عنده شرط فلا يقبل عمله.
As for the second category, there are people who are sincere when they do the acts of worship, it is for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, but they fell short in following the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in the acts of worship. So because they've missed out one of the two conditions of the conditions of the acts of worship being accepted, the actions unfortunately won't be accepted.
والدليل على ذلك ما رواه مسلم في صحيحه أن ثلاثة رهط، يعني ثلاثة رجال، جاءوا إلى أبيات النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم يسألون عن عبادته في السر، فلما عرفوا عبادته صلى الله عليه وسلم في بيته كأنهم تقالوها، يعني قالوا هذه عبادة قليلة ونحن نستطيع أن نعمل أكثر.
The evidence for this, that the second group actions won't be accepted, the people who are sincere but they don't follow the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, is the hadith which is collected by and reported by Sahih Muslim, that three men came to the houses of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam asking about the worship of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Then when they were informed about the worship of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, taqalun, that they belittled this worship. They said, we can do a lot more than this is nothing.
فقال أحد هؤلاء الثلاثة أنا أصلي ولا أرقد، وقال الثاني أنا أصوم الدهر أبدا، وقال الثالث لا أتزوج النساء. فبلغت مقالتهم النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم فقال عليه الصلاة والسلام: ما بال أقوام يقولون كذا وكذا، فأما أنا أصلي وأرقد وأصوم وأفطر وأتزوج النساء، فمن رغب عن سنتي فليس مني، ليس على طريقتي ولا على هدي. من لم يرغب بسنة النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم فأنى أو كيف يقبل عمله؟
And when they were informed of the worship of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and they belittled it and said, "We can do a lot more than this. This is nothing." And this, their wordings were reached the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He said, "ما بال أقوام؟" What is wrong with it? What is the matter with the people who say such and such and such and such? As for me, then I pray, and I also sleep, and I fast, and there are days I don't fast, and I marry women. فَمَنْ رَغِبَ عَنْ سُنَّتِي فَلَيْسَ مِنِّي. So whomsoever deliberately intends other than my sunnah, he wants other than my sunnah, he looks for other than my sunnah like these three men did, فَلَيْسَ مِنِّي, then he is not from me. So a person who deliberately intends to have his acts of worship and his methodology in worship other than the way of the Prophet ﷺ, then how will his worship ever be accepted?
فَهَؤُلَاءِ كَمَا تُلَاحِظُونَ عِنْدَهُمْ إِخْلَاصٌ لكن ليست عندهم متابعة لهدي النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم ولا سنته ولا هديه في العمل، ولهذا لا يقبل منهم ذلك العمل ما لم يكن موافقا لسنة النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم.
So these three men, they were sincere, they had sincerity, the first condition from the conditions of their worship being accepted, but they clearly intendedly wanted other than the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, so that acts of worship won't be accepted.
القسم الثالث عكس هذا القسم الثاني، قوم عندهم عمل يوافق هدي النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم ولكن ليس عندهم إخلاص في ذلك العمل، فإما أن يكون رياء أو نحو ذلك، نسأل الله السلام. فالقسم الثاني فقد المتابعة ووجد الإخلاص، وفي القسم الثالث وجد ماذا؟
وجد المتابعة.
المتابعة وفقد الإخلاص، وفقد الإخلاص. وهذا أيضا مثل الثالث، عمله غير مقبول لأنه لم يرد بذلك العمل وجه الله تبارك وتعالى.
As for the third category from the four, when it pertains to these two conditions of the conditions of worship, there are people who are opposite to the second. They follow the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam's methodology in worship. Their acts of worship are in accordance to the Sunnah and the way of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, but they have missed out on the first condition, the condition of sincerity, whether it's them showing off or any other reason which nullifies the sincerity for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa taala. So this group is just like the group before them. Their actions won't be accepted. Yes, they have followed the way of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, but due to their insincerity for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the actions are غير مقبول. It is not going to be accepted by Allah.
ولهذا يحذر المسلم في هذا الباب أشد الحذر من الرياء، لأنه يعمل بهدي النبي عليه الصلاة والسلام ويعمل العمل الذي أمر به عليه الصلاة والسلام، لكنه يرائي به الناس أو من أجل فلان أو من أجل أن يقال كذا، كما ورد في هذا الحديث الذي رواه الإمام مسلم أيضا في صحيحه عن أبي هريرة رضي الله تعالى عنه أنه قال: سمعت النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم يقول: أول من يقضى عليه يوم القيامة رجل عرفه الله بنعمه فعرفها، وهذا الرجل استشهد في سبيل الله، فقال: كيف فعلت بنعمي عليك يا عبدي؟ قال: جاهدت فيك حتى استشهدت. فيقول الله تبارك وتعالى: كذبت، وهو الذي يعلم السر وأخفى ويعلم ما تخفي الصدور. قال: كذبت، ولكنك حتى يقال أن فلانا جريء وشجاع، وقد قيل فيسحب على وجهه إلى النار عياذا بالله. عمل عملا مشروعا ولكنه فاقد للإخلاص لله تبارك وتعالى.
That's why the Muslim should take caution and take the most caution, أشد الحذر. He should take extreme caution when it pertains to this category of people and not being from them. A people who their actions are in accordance to Al-Islam and the Sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, but they're insincere individuals, whether they're showing off, whether so they their name could be mentioned, or for a particular person, or for a particular worldly purpose. And the Sheikh narrates quite a scary hadith. The hadith narrated in Sahih Muslim, reported by Abi Hurairah radiallahu anhu, says the Prophet sallallahu alaihi, he said, I heard the message of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam saying that the first person that the fire will be ignited with, the first person the fire will be set alight on, is a person who was martyred in the path of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And after Allah affirms for him and makes him acknowledge his blessings, he's going to say, why did you do what you did? Why did you fight and end up becoming a martyr? He said, I did these actions for your sake. And Allah will say to him, kadhabt, you've lied, you're telling a lie. Rather you did it so you can be said, jari, is brave, or suja', courageous. And he will be commanded by the angels to be, Allah will command the angels to take him, and he'll be dragged on his face to the hellfire. So these people, they did an action which is prescribed. He did jihad, which is from the most loftiest of actions. But because it was insincere, it led to this very despicable, scary outcome.
والثاني ذكر في الحديث النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم رجل قرأ القرآن وتعلم العلم فعرفه الله نعمه فعرفها وقال الله له ماذا فعلت في هذه النعم؟ قال يا ربي تعلمت القرآن وعلمت العلم فيك. فيقال له كذبت، وإنما قرأت وعلمت لكي يقال عالم. فيسحب على وجهه في النار، نسأل الله السلامة. فالعلم مطلوب وقراءة القرآن مطلوبة، لكن مع الإخلاص لله تبارك وتعالى.
And the Sheikh continues narrating the hadith, and the second person who will be ignited with the fire as well, or from the first types of people who the fire will be ignited and set alight with, may Allah protect all of us, is a person who learned the Quran, who recited the Qur'an, who memorized the Qur'an and learned knowledge. And Allah will remind him of his blessings and he will come to know them. And Allah will ask him, what did you do with these blessings? And he will reply, I learned the Qur'an, I learned knowledge, I taught knowledge for your sake. Allah will say to him, you're lying, you've lied. Rather, you learned knowledge, you memorized the Qur'an, you recited the Qur'an, you learned knowledge, so you can be said an alim, a scholar, or a reciter, or a qari. Then Allah will command the angel to take him and he will be dragged on his face to the hellfire. The Shaykh said, نسأل الله العافية، وأسأل الله for safety and protection.
والثالث رجل آتاه الله مالا فعرفه الله نعمه فعرفها وقال له ماذا فعلت بهذه النعم؟ فيقول يا ربي أنفقت في وجوه سبيلك الكثيرة هذا المال. فيقول الله تبارك وتعالى كذبت، وإنما أنفقت ليقال محسن. الإنفاق كان شيئا مطلوبا ولكن الإخلاص كان مفقودا، فلم ينفعه ذلك الإخلاص. ولهذا ذكر النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم من السبعة
لم ينفع ذلك العمل.
لم ينفعه، نعم
قلت إخلاص،
ها
قلت لم ينفعه ذلك الإخلاص،
لم ينفعه ذلك العمل، ولم ينفعه يعني ذلك العمل لأنه لم يخلص فيه. نعم حسن. فالشاهد أفضل النفقة أو الصدقة، وذكر النبي عليه الصلاة والسلام من السبع الذين يظلهم تحت ظله يوم لا ظل إلا ظله، ورجل تصدق بصدقة فأخفاها حتى لا تعلم شماله ما تنفق يمينه. هذا فيه إخلاص وفيه قرب من الله تبارك وتعالى وفيه بعد عن الرياء. أحسنت.
أحسن الله عليكم. And the Shaykh, may Allah preserve him and reward him, mentions, finishes the hadith, the third, or the final person who the fire will be ignited with and set alight with, may Allah protect all of us, is a person who had Allah give him wealth and he spent it apparently in the cause of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Then when he'll come to stand before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allah will ask him and remind him of his blessings and then ask him, what did you do with these blessings? And he'll reply, I spent this money in your sake. I spent this money in your path. And Allah will say to him, kadabt, you are lying and you've told a lie. Rather, you spent this money so you can be said a muhsin, a good doer, so you can, your name can be known amongst the people. So this person, he had an action which was mushru', an action which is legislated, charity in the path of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But because he missed this condition of sincerity, it led to this outcome. So the best of actions, the best of knowledge, the best of jihad, the best of spending, is a spending which is done for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And from the seven types of people who will be shaded on the Day of Judgment, a day where there is no shade except the shade of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, is an individual, a man who gave in charity, and it was so secret, he gave so much, he kept his charity so hidden that his left hand did not know what his right hand had given, i.e. he was kept this action between him and himself only. So this action, which was not only a legislated action, but it was sincere for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, far from shirk and any showing off, was action which benefited him in the hereafter.
القسم الرابع وهو القسم الأخير وهو من أخلص لله تبارك وتعالى العمل في قلبه ووافق بعمله هدي النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم فوافق قلبه عمله فإنه يقصد بذلك العمل وجه الله تبارك وتعالى ولا يقصد به أحدا سواه عز وجل ويتابع في ذلك العمل هدي النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم وسنته ولم يحدث في ذلك العمل شيئا لا بزيادة ولا بنقص. نعم.
As for the fourth category of people, what it pertains to these two conditions is the people whose actions were for Allah's sake. They had sincerity for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and likewise the actions were in accordance and upon the way of our Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. As for the actions, it was for Allah's sake and Allah's sake alone, only seeking His pleasure. And the actions were actions which were in accordance to the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, without any addition or any subtracting. قلتم أخيرا شيخ؟
كيف؟
قلتم أخيرا؟ لا زيادة
نقصان؟ لا لا نعم تنزيا ولا نقصان. طيب فهذا القسم هو الناجي وهذا القسم هو المطلوب منا جميعا أسأل الله عز وجل أن يرزقنا الإخلاص في القول والعمل وأن يبعدنا عن الرياء وعن الشرك وعن العمل الذي لا يوافق هدي النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم.
So this category, they are the saved category from the four. The people whose actions were for Allah's sake, i.e. they had sincerity, and the actions were following the methodology and the way of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So this is what is required from all of us, that we are sincere individuals, and individuals who follow the way of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And the Shaykh said, we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sincerely to protect us and not make us from any of the other categories, and make us people who are sincere and follow the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam.
فَإِن كُنْتَ يَا عَبْدَ اللَّهِ تُرِيدُ مِنَ اللَّهِ تَبَارَكَ وَتَعَالَى قبول عبادتك فعرضها على هذين الأصلين العظيمين الإخلاص والمتابعة.
So if you, O servant of Allah, Ya Abdullah, want your actions to be accepted, you want your actions to be accepted by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then place your actions upon these two yardsticks, or upon this scale, the scale of sincerity and following the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam.
قال الله تعالى الذي خلق الموت والحياة ليبلوكم أيكم أحسن عملا قال الفضيل ابن عياض العمل الحسن هو العمل الذي يكون صوابا ويكون العبد فيه مخلصا لله تبارك وتعالى.
The Sheikh mentioned the statement of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the second ayah of Surah Al-Mulk, that Allah is the one who created death and life, لِيَبَلُوَكُمْ أَيُّكُمْ أَحْسَنُ عَمَلًا, to test which one of you is best in action. That's why Allah created death and life. The Shaykh mentions the commentary of Fudayl ibn Iyad, رحمه الله تعالى. What does it mean? The best of actions. To test which one of you is best in action. The best of actions here is that which is correct, i.e. following the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. وَيْكُونَ الْعَبْدُ فِيهِ مُخْلَسًا. And the servant is in it sincere for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala.
فَيَجِبُ حَقِيقَةً عَلَى الْمُسْلِمِينَ وَالْمُؤْمِنِينَ لِتَكُونَ أَعْمَالَهُمْ مَقْبُولَ عِنْدَ اللَّهِ تَبَارَكَ وَتَعَالَى مُتَابَعَةَ النَّبِيِّ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمْ فِي مَا أَمَرْ وَاجْتِنَابُ مَا نَهَى عَنْهُ وَزَجَرْ وأن لا يعبد الله تبارك وتعالى إلا بما شرع وأن يخلص العبد في هذه العبادة لله تبارك وتعالى ولا يريد بها سوى الله تبارك وتعالى ويحذر من الرياء وأن يصرف شيء من العبادات لغير الله تبارك وتعالى فإنها حينئذ تكون مردودة عليه غير مقبولة.
So it's obligatory, mandatory, befitting upon every Muslim and upon every believer that the actions are sincere and in line and in suit with the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and that they obey the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam that which he commanded, and they obey him in that which he prohibited, and they only worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with his legislation, and that they stay far away from any means which will nullify the actions, whether it's riya, showing off, or any form of shirk. No.
ولهذا من الأمور المهمة في الإخلاص لله تبارك وتعالى أن يعرف العبد ربه معرفة جيدة، أن يعرف الله تبارك وتعالى وأن يعظمه عز وجل وأن يوحده ولا يشرك به شيئا، فهذه الأمور مما تزيد في إخلاص العبد في عمله لله تبارك وتعالى، تعظيم الله وتوحيده سبحانه وتعالى وعدم الإشراك به عز وجل والإكثار من ذكره سبحانه وتعالى.
As for that which pertains to sincerity for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then that which will aid you and assist you in attaining this condition is ma'rifatullah, knowing Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and having knowledge of him and venerating him, ta'zeemuhu, when you exalt Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, wa tawheeduhu, and that you single out Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and this is our matters which will only aid you and rather increase you in your sincerity, and likewise being constant in his remembrance and his dhikr.
وكذلك مما يساعد في قبول العمل تعظيم السنة النبوية والأخذ بها ومتابعة النبي عليه الصلاة والسلام بفهم سلف هذه الأمة من الصحابة الكرام رضي الله تعالى عنهم أجمعين ومن تبعهم بإحسان والأئمة المتبوعين إلى يوم الدين، ونسأل الله أن يجعلنا نقتفي أثرهم ونسير بسيرهم على هذا الفهم الصحيح، وألا نتبع يعني غير النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم في هديه وفي شريعته عليه الصلاة والسلام.
And likewise, that which will aid you in attaining the second condition is تعظيم سنة النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم, that you venerate and you exalt, and it's something big in your heart, the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, in taking it, in acting upon it, in understanding it, of having knowledge of it. Likewise, not just taking it, but taking it with the correct understanding, the understanding of the Salaf, the early Muslims, the companions, and the Tabi'een, and the Asba'u Tabi'een, and the Imams who came after them. And we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us from those who follow the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and these noble من السلف and follow them in their footsteps.
ولو سأل سائل ما الفائدة من الإخلاص في الأعمال ومتابعة النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم فيها، فإن في ذلك فوائد عظيمة، فإذا تابع العبد ربه تابع نبيه صلى الله عليه وسلم وأخلص في العمل لله تبارك وتعالى، فإن هذا من باب الاعتصام بكتاب الله وبحبل الله وسنة رسوله. واعتصموا بحبل الله جميعا ولا تفرقوا، فإنه تحصل ألفة بين المسلمين فيما بينهم، لأنهم سيكونون على منهج واحد وعلى طريق واحد.
And if a person asked, what is the benefit in a person being sincere and a person who followed the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, then Sheikh said, indeed, there are numerous benefits which will come from this. From the many of them is, this is from al-i'tisam bi kitabillahi wa sunnati nabiyhi. This is from holding on and clinging on to the Qur'an and the sunnah which Allah commanded us to do in the Qur'an. And if we all were sincere, and we all follow the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, what will happen is the ummah will be united because they're all clinging onto and holding fast onto the same things.
فإنه لن يكون بينهم اختلاف ولا افتراق بدليل أنهم تابعوا النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم في عبادتهم وأخلصوا ذلك العمل لله تبارك وتعالى. والثانية أنه يبعدون من الشرك ولا يكون ذلك الأمر الخطير موجودا بينهم، لأنهم تمسكوا بهدي النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم وأخلصوا هذه العبادة لله تبارك وتعالى وحده. نعم.
So if they all were sincere and followed the sunnah of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم and clinged onto these, then there will be no differing and there'll be no splitting amongst the ummah. Rather, they'll be united. As for the second of the many benefits of being sincere and following the sunnah, is they will be far and free and distant from shirk, that which is the worst of calamities.
وأنه ستكون حياتهم حياة طيبة. ولهذا ننظر أو نجد في عصر الصحابة وسلف هذه الأمة لم يكن بينهم اختلاف في الدين، لأنهم علموا سنة النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم وأخلصوا في عملهم لله تبارك وتعالى، فهم أمة واحدة وهم فرقة ناجية، كما أخبر النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم من أن هذه الأمة ستختلف وتفترق، ولكن النجاة تكون في العودة إلى كتاب الله وسنة رسوله صلى الله عليه وسلم، يعني عودة صحيحة بفهم صحيح. ولهذا قال في حديث العرباض بن سارية: فإنه من يعش منكم فسيرى اختلافا كثيرا. نعم.
And from the ample benefits of following the sunnah of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم and being sincere is that you will have حياة طيبة, a pleasant wonderful life, as that which is apparent in the time and lives of the Prophet, of the companions of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. They did not differ with that which pertains to their religion, and rather we will be like them, an ummah wahida, one body and one nation, and we will be inshallah ta'ala the saved sect, as the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam told us that this ummah will split into many many different sects, and those who are going to be saved and those who are going to be saved are those who return back to the sunnah and are sincere individuals with that, all of the actions, as which is mentioned in the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam collected in Abi Dawud and Tirmidhi, the hadith of
Arbad bin Sariyah.
Arbad bin Sariyah, hadith number 28 from Arba'een. Whoever lives amongst you will see many differing. So what should you do? فَعَلَيْكُمْ بِسُنَّتِي, upon you is my sunnah, وسنة الخلفاء الراشدين المهديين, and likewise the sunnah of my rightly guided caliphs, i.e. the companions of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم.
فالإخلاص والمتابعة في العبادة هو المطلوب منا يا عباد الله في هذه الدنيا لكي تكون أعمالنا عند الله مقبولة. فإنه لا يقبل العمل إلا بهذين الشرطين وبهذين الأصلين العظيمين: الإخلاص لله تبارك وتعالى فيه، والمتابعة فيه لهدي النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم.
So these two points, sincerity and following the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, that which is what is required from us, and that is what is asked of us in this dunya when it pertains to our worship. And then that, inshallah ta'ala, will be that which will benefit us in the hereafter, because our actions without them will not be accepted. And with them, inshallah ta'ala, will be accepted. Sincerity for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and following the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام.
فهذا يعني ما تيسر ذكره في هذا الموضوع, وأن الإخلاص في العمل والمتابعة فيه لهدي النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم يكون ذخرا للعبد يوم القيامة في صحيفته يوم يلقى الله عز وجل. فإن هذا العمل هو العمل المقبول إذا تابع العبد فيه نبيه واهتدى بهديه وأخلص قبل ذلك فيه لله تبارك وتعالى.
Sheikh, so this is what has been made easy to mention today. So that which you have of sincere actions, which is in line with the Sunnah of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, this will be for you دخرا يوم القيامة. This will be something which will be saved for you, something which you have saved on the Day of Judgment, and something you will find on your scroll of good deeds, as this is the action which is accepted by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala.
فأوصيكم ونفسي بهذا بالإخلاص في أعمالنا وعباداتنا لله تبارك وتعالى, وكذلك متابعة هدي النبي عليه الصلاة والسلام وأخذ سنته من مصادرها الصحيحة. لا نأخذ أي حديث قد يكون ضعيفا أو موضوعا أو مكذوبا أو معلا ونقول هذا من سنة النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم. ولهذا يحذر المسلم في المتابعة إلا أن يأخذ هذه الأحاديث بفهم السلف الصالح, وكذلك يأخذها من أهل العلم الربانيين المعروفين الموثوق بهم ومن مصادرها. ومن أعظم مصادر الحديث الصحيح كتاب الصحيحين للبخاري ومسلم وصحيح ابن حبان وصحيح ابن خزيمة شيخه وغير ذلك مما صح وثبت عن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم في كتب السنن والمسانيد والمصنفات وغيرها.
And the Sheikh mentioned, so it's upon all of us what pertains to following the sunnah of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, is that we follow it, but likewise we follow it and take it from its authentic, correct sources. And the Sheikh mentioned, we don't just take any hadith that we come across, because the hadith could be inauthentic, could be weak, or it could be mawdu', completely made up, right? So we take the hadith from its correct sources, from the ulama of hadith, from the scholars of this religion, and from its authentic sources, such as the books of hadith, which are authentic, such as Sahih al-Bukhari, Sahih Muslim, Sahih ibn Hibban, Sahih ibn Khuzaymah.
أود أن أذكر سؤالا. نحن ذكرنا أربعة أقسام للناس, فنذكر حديث الآن, وعلى أي قسم يكون ذلك منها؟ حديث رواه البخاري ومسلم أن أبا بردة بن نيار رضي الله عنه صلى مع النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم صلاة العيد, فقال النبي عليه الصلاة والسلام: من صلى معنا صلاتنا ونسك نسكنا فقد أتى بالسنة, وكما قال عليه الصلاة والسلام. وقال هذا الصحابي: أنا ذبحت ذبيحتي أو نسكت نسكي قبل صلاة العيد. فرد النبي عليه الصلاة والسلام قال: إنما شاتك شات لحم لم تأتي بها في الوقت الذي هو محلها. ثم قال: عندي عناق أو جذع خير من ما ذبحت. فأذن له النبي عليه الصلاة والسلام لأنها لا تجزي, قال: لك لوحدك. فهذا الصحابي رضي الله تعالى عنه عمل عملا ليس على هدي النبي عليه الصلاة والسلام من باب الخطأ, وليس من باب القصد, من باب الخطأ. نعم. ونريد أن نعرف ما حكم ذلك العمل؟
So the Sheikh wants to ask all of you a question now.
نحن قلنا إخلاص وموافقة، إخلاص وغير موافقة، وعدم إخلاص وموافقة، والأخير يعني الإخلاص والموافقة. نعم.
The Sheikh said he wants to pose to all of you a question. So we mentioned the categories of people and how they split when it comes to sincerity and following the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. His Sheikh is going to mention a hadith. He's already mentioned it. In this hadith, he wants you guys to put it under which this situation and scenario, under which category from the four does it fall under. So one of the companions of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam prayed with the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam salatul Eid, and he had, after the prayer, told the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, "I've already slaughtered my dhabiha, my slaughtering, before even the prayer." And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam told him, "Shatuka shatu lahmin," that your slaughtering is just, it says meat. It's not slaughtering, which is slaughtering of worship. Then the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said, "I've got an animal which is better than it. Can I slaughter it now?" And the Prophet allowed him to slaughter. So this companion, he opposed the timing when the slaughtering takes place. The slaughtering can only take place after Salatul Eid, Eid al-Adha, not Eid al-Fitr, of course. Right? So he did his slaughtering before the prayer, but the timing usually starts when? After the prayer, as we all know. So which category, or this situation, is it for, which category does he fall under from the four that we mentioned? Pardon? The second category, which is the people who have
مخلص
إخلاص
وغير متابع. هو مخلص الصحابي رضي الله تعالى عنه، لكن لم يقره النبي عليه الصلاة والسلام على فعله، وبين له أن هذا ليس من السنة، وإنما السنة تكون بعد صلاة العيد، لكنه ذبح ذبيحته قبل صلاة العيد.
هذا كان من حرصه؟
نعم، يعني لا يعلم، هو أخطأ، ليس قصداً، لا يقصد المخالفة، وإنما خطأ. لكن نحن نريد أن نقول أن هذا العمل حتى ولو من الصحابي، إذا لم يوافق هدي النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم لم يكن مقبولا، ولذا قال له عليه الصلاة والسلام: شاتك شات لحم، ليست أضحية، وليست نسك مقبولة، فذبح بدلا عنها رضي الله تعالى عنه بعد ما سمع هذا القول من النبي عليه الصلاة والسلام، وأن الذبيحة أو الأضحية لا تذبح إلا بعد صلاة العيد، إلا بعد صلاة العيد في يوم الأضحى، فمن ذبحها قبل الصلاة فإنها لا تجزئ.
نعم. So the Sheikh wanted to further emphasize and give an example. Sometimes examples make things clear. That even if it's a companion from the companions of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, and even if they were sincere, because this companion, he was sincere. And he only even made a mistake. He didn't even do it on purpose. It was khata, and he did it by accident, or he didn't know. But because he was missing the action or the condition of following the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, his act of worship, his dhabiha, was not considered even a dhabiha. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam told us, "Shatuka shatu lahmin," that your sheep is only shat of lahm. It's just meat. It was like any other day. So the Sheikh wanted to give an example to further clarify, even if it's a companion, and even if it's by accident, it's not enough for a person to be sincere, but he also has to follow the suit of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم.
ولهذا نأخذ من هذا الحديث أن الاجتهاد في العبادة مطلوب، اجتهد الإنسان فيما شرع له، هذا أمر مطلوب، لكن يجتهد في كيفية العبادة، هذا أمر محذور، لا يجوز الإنسان يجتهد في كيفية العبادة وهيئتها، بل يتبع فيها سنة النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم.
So the Sheikh said that الاجتهاد في العبادة, working hard and striving when it comes to the acts of worship, is something which is requested and befitting for all of us to do, that we work hard in the actions which are مشروع, which are legislated, right? And even in the actions which are legislated, we work hard in them in the way the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam allowed it. So we cannot work hard in act of worship which is legislated, but in our own way, such as the prayer. This is an act of worship which is legislated, but we cannot work hard in our own way. It has to be, even the detail, even the how, according to the how of the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام.
أشكر لكم هذا الوقت وأسأل الله عز وجل أن ينفعنا وإياكم بما قلنا وسمعنا وتدارسنا فيه جميعا، وأسأل الله عز وجل لي ولكم أن يجعل أعمالنا خالصة وأن تكون صالحة وموافقة لهدي النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم، وأن تكون خالصة لوجهه سبحانه وتعالى، وألا يجعل فيها حظا ولا نصيبا لأي أحد. أقول هذا القول وأسأل الله عز وجل المغفرة لي ولكم، وصلى الله وسلم على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين.
The Sheikh concludes by thanking all of you for listening attentively. And the Sheikh asks Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that he allows us to benefit from that which was said and that which was heard. And he makes our actions saliha, righteous and khalisa, and for Allah's sake only, and in accordance with the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, so they are accepted in the hereafter. And the Shaykh said he asks for me and for all of you forgiveness from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and he makes dua for Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam.